Hi.
Hey. Hi, everybody.
I'm Gia.
I'm Donna.
And I'm Mike.
And we're InVolo Papillons. And we're going to show you Papillons today. Everything you ever wanted to know about them. Okay. So, to start...
It's not up to you.
To start, we have bred nearly 100 champions in about 25 years. I've done it since I was a little tiny kid. We have had the top winning pap of all time, as well as the only best in show littermates in the history of a breed. We bred and own the only Papillon to win the group at the AKC National Championship, and the only Papillon to win the thread by group at the AKC National Championship. So just a little bit of history on paps. They were called the Continental Toy Spaniel. They were first depicted in portraits in the 14th century with the old masters. They were originally drop ears pictured, only drop ears, which is called a feline. In the 19th century is when the first erect ear appeared. They were royal pets of the nobility. There's some question on what country Papillons originated in. It's said to be France, it's said to be Belgium, it's said to be Spain. But Papillon is the French word for butterfly. So what we're basically going to do is start with, we have a total of 6 dogs that you'll see, and we're going to start with their heads, and we're going to go through each dog and show the head of each dog, and then we'll go through the bodies. We'll basically do the last dog, we'll do the head, the body, and then we'll do the bodies on the first 5. So if you guys have any questions on each individual dog, we could answer them at the end of the dog for each of the 2 sections. So but just basically to start, the Papillon is a small, elegant toy dog of fine bone structure that is distinguished from other breeds by its butterfly-like ears. So the head and the ears would be your first basic elements of breed type. So just to start us out, the head is small. So the head is small of medium width. The muzzle is fine, abruptly finer than the head. And it is 1/3, the nose to the occiput, or the nose to the stop is 1/3, 2/3 the length of the stop to the occiput. So 1/3, 2/3. The nose is black. All pigment is black. No matter the color, the pigment is black. So the bite is scissors. Undershot or overshot is a fault. And the markings, basically, the markings are mentioned in our standard. So a blaze, a clearly defined white blaze, which would be this, is preferred to a solid head. Symmetry of markings is also desirable, so that is important. Now, that is often said to be the icing on the cake. I think it's explicitly stated in the standard, so I don't think it's the icing on the cake, but I do think that if you have a dog that is a better dog, that is solid-headed, certainly reward the dog that's a better dog. The eyes are small and well set in. They're on the corner of the eye is on line with the stop. It is a well-defined stop, which you can see easily from the side. As I said, it's slightly rounded between the ears. So then we get to the ears. The ears are the hallmark of our breed. But keep in mind, whenever the ears are mentioned, the ear set is when alert. So on the table, many Papillons will not give you as much expression as you might like. We typically tell judges to judge on the ground as far as the ear set. The ear set is, again, 45 degrees when alert. Ears are large, rounded. If there's any question on them being round, you can always feel the tips. They're never pointed. There are some faults listed in our standard for ears. Ears should never be small. They should never be pointed. They should never be one up or one down. They should never be somewhat up, somewhat down. We never ever want judges to reward a dog, no matter the age, that does not have its ears erect. Papillon ears are carried obliquely and move like the wings of a spread butterfly. So when they're moving, they certainly are not just totally up. They can be back, they can be moving. They should never drop. We do have a drop ear, which is called a feline. I had posted earlier in the week, if you guys want to see some more photos of the felines, as we don't presently have one to show you guys. So the Papillon and the feline have the exact same standard. The feline is just a drop ear version of a Papillon. And their appearance, their temperament, everything is the same, their movement. There is a couple lines in the standard that explain the ears. The ears are carried drooping. They are completely down. So there should be no question on whether or not it's a Papillon or a feline. Can you guys grab one of the other dogs just to just kind of finish up this dog? At the beginning of the standard, the height is specified. Papillons are 8 to 11 inches, so there is no bottom on the height standard. There is a top. Over 11 is a fault. 12 inches is a disqualification. So when you, if as judges, when you wicket a Papillon, you're going to wicket at 12 inches.
Who do you want?
That being said, Grace. With that being said, over 11 is a fault. It is a fault just like any other fault. It is no more important. And while we're waiting for the other dog, there are three DQs mentioned in our standard. One of them is 12 inches, as I mentioned. Over 12 inches is a disqualification. An all-white dog or a dog with no white, all of those would be disqualifications. For the judges, there are a couple of severely penalized faults. Those would be a nose that is not black. So as I mentioned earlier, the nose is always black. The nose is small, flat on top. The lips, you can never ever see the bite, the tongue, when the mouth is closed. And then the other would be what is called a miss mark. So generally speaking, you won't see those in the ring, but the way that our color works is specified in our standard is both ears are covered in a color other than white, back and front. So you won't see any white on the ears. And then both eyes have to be covered as well in black. They must be covered from the eyes to the ears in an unbroken line. So basically what that means is you would never see white right here or here in between the blaze and the color of the ear. Okay, I'm gonna show you guys another dog. So this is a bitch. She's probably about 10 inches in height. And just to cover heads again on her, so basically, just to reiterate, as we said, the head is small. Obviously, her markings are fine. So her markings would be what we consider to be very well marked. This is not required. The last dog would be a little bit darker. That's absolutely fine as well. This is a tricolor. He was a tricolor as well. We'll cover the areas of the standard on color as we go. But just to recap kind of on her, you see her muzzle is fine, slight, abruptly thinner than the size of her head, tapers to her head. Her eyes are dark. Her eyes could be, you may have to zoom in, a little bit darker. You can see kind of some brown, which we would prefer more of a black eye. But as the standard says, dark. So just kind of depends on the deviation of the fault. It doesn't take away from the alert, pleasing expression. Her ears are large, well fringed. She's a little bit younger than the other dog. The other dog was 4. This bitch is 2. So as you can see, it's a little bit less ear fringe. Still absolutely acceptable, appropriate. We will cover later different ages so you can kind of see the maturity level on them. as you can see, Papillons are pretty alert and expressive. And this is kind of what we were talking about on the table. So they will never stand just like a soldier. You may see some specials that may do that, but that is not common. This is how Papillons live their everyday life. This is how they are all day, every day. They're happy. They never meet a stranger. Our standard act, the words in our standard to describe temperament are neither shy nor aggressive, happy, friendly. So they do not penalize a dog that is like this. This is normal. This is absolutely what we want. It's what we expect. It's what they should be. So as I said about her head, it's a very pretty head. Also very similar to the other dog, similar type. The other dog would be pretty close to ideal. And we'll show him again so you guys can see his head. Do you want to grab Lucifer? Let's do Phoebe.
Mike, can you get me back on that page? I'm coming.
And this way, even in my arms, you can kind of see how they carry their ears. They move back and forth. They go up. They can lower. So those are all totally acceptable positions for a pap. They will not constantly be up. And as I said, to reiterate, Papillon's ears are set at a 45-degree angle when alert.
Okay.
And that would be typically something you would look at on the ground.
You might want to mention looking from the back for the judges.
Lucifer next. So this is another bitch. And this bitch, so this is what we call a red sable. This is also allowed in our standard. Now this bitch has kind of, to touch on markings, hers are a little bit darker. So she pretty much has what we would call a pencil blaze. She also has a smudge on her show side. So as I mentioned, a clearly defined white blaze is preferred. So she does have a blaze. Symmetry of markings is preferred. So her smudge would not be considered symmetrical. Despite that, she is a very, very typey bitch. So now her ear, so she, as I mentioned, is a red sable. You will often hear that reds or red sables do not carry ear fringe, do not carry coat. Obviously, that's not true. That would just be a question of genetics and lines and the way things run. Again, to reiterate, so she would be what I would consider to be a little bit more exaggerated in head, while still being correct, but definitely a little more exaggerated than the last bitch. She's a little finer here. As the standard says, it should be abruptly finer than the head. She's still, so as we mentioned earlier, round eyes, black pigment, a clearly defined stop, a scissors bite, and the ears. So the ears are large, well fringed. And again, you can kind of see how she is, you know, fighting it a little bit on the table. So that's why it's so important to judge the ear set on the ground. Another trick for the ear set that can be a good one if you do have a question is if you look at a Papillon's ears from behind, which this would be where her ears are pretty typically when alert. So if you look, it's a 45-degree angle, which of course would be half of 90. So you can kind of see it from behind sometimes a bit better. And again, it would be on the ground than you might see it on the table. So we've got another dog we're going to show you guys.
I can't get on.
I cannot do it.
Okay, maybe you can. Here.
So this is a male. And a male, he's also a red sable. He's the sire of the last bitch. He's actually a sire of both of those bitches. So again, we can kind of cover the head on another dog in another color. So the head is small, slightly rounded.
The ears are large, well fringed. Again, it's a red dog, plenty of ear fringe. As we said, we're going to judge the ear set on the ground, but 45 degrees when alert. The pigment is black. So you see, this dog is a red sable and the last dog is a red sable. And this pigment is no different than any other dog. So you see the black around the eyes would be the same as it was a tricolor dog. The muzzle is abruptly finer than the head. There is a well-defined stop. Remember, we said 1/3 from the nose to the stop, 2/3 from the stop to the occiput. And again, as we mentioned, the ears, 45 degrees when alert. And then we have one more dog for you.
Hi, everyone.
Okay, so now we're gonna do, this is the last one we're gonna show you as far as the heads go. And then we'll get into the bodies more. We'll start with her and then go back through the others. So this is a 12-month-old bitch. And you can kind of see the maturity level is very different. Totally acceptable for her age, but very, very different. So to start with her head is small. Her head is not as rounded as we would like behind the ears. You can kind of see it's a little bit flatter on top. There's her ears so you can see them. So her stop is not as well defined as we would like. It's a little more slopey through here. Scissors bite as well. She is a tricolor. Again, to talk about the markings, she would be something we would consider to be perfectly marked, not required. She does have a clearly defined blaze. She does have symmetry of markings. Her eyes are maybe a little small. All kind of lends itself to not as pleasing of an expression as the others. Her ears are large. Her ears are well fringed for her age. Everything is relative. So, you know, as I mentioned, this bitch is not going to have at 12 months that the ear fringe that any of the past dogs have at 2 years or four or three. Again, her ears are large. They're well fringed. They are round. I would say they're pretty well set. And if we could kind of show from the back. So this is another interesting thing to point out as far as color goes, if you come up top. So if you see this bitch on the back of her head, she has some tan, and she also has it in her ears. That's totally acceptable. As we mentioned earlier, color is not really important as far as preference or anything like that. The size, the shape, or the absence or presence of patches of color, whether it be on the head or the body, are immaterial. So we're gonna kind of segue into body. So as we mentioned earlier, they are an elegant, elegant dog. So you should never lose the elegance, and that goes for any size. So we'll do kind of some size comparisons later for you guys to see. But to start with this bitch, as we mentioned, 8 to 11 inches over 11 is a fault, 12 is a DQ. This bitch would be pretty close to 11 inches. So just to give you guys a good idea of what that looks like. But to point out, she still has hair feet. So the feet should be hair feet, like a rabbit. The hair on the feet is short. It can grow to a point in the front of the foot. They should never be round. And then you'll also see her bone is fine. Her forelegs are thin, slender, point neither in nor out. The same goes for the rear legs. Fine, slender, pointing either in nor out. They should be parallel when viewed from behind. But just with this bitch, it's very important to see that this is a large bitch, but it is still a fine bone dog. Also to cover proportions. So our standard says slightly longer than tall. So that would be measured, of course, from here to here. Now the top line should be level. The neck is of medium length. I would say that this is a necky bitch. Not something typically to be penalized in a breeding program or in the ring. As she matures, as she gets more coat, more body, you'll see a little less, you know, the coat does somewhat change the shape a little bit. It doesn't change the shape fundamentally, but it changes the perception. And that's totally normal. As we mentioned, the top line is level. So then if we go to the tail is a very important part of breed type. It is one of the explicitly mentioned things as far as faults go. So our tails should come straight off the back. The croup should never be low. And you should always see daylight under a Papillon tail. It's often called a teacup tail. So it would be like the teacup of a mug or a tea kettle, something like that. You should always see air under the tail, which you can very easily see on a bitch of this age and maturity. With an older dog, it might be important to feel, you know, if you're judging the dog. So we'll show you a puppy a little bit later, a younger puppy. As I said, it's quite evident on dogs younger. But if you are in doubt, feel it, you know, feel below. As far as structure, they are a dog that has no anomalies movement-wise. Our gait is mentioned as free, quick, and easy. Neither paddle-footed nor stiff in hip movement. Shoulders should be well-developed and laid back. So as we mentioned, a pretty generically sound dog. They should also have well-developed and well-angulated hindquarters. As we mentioned, they should be inclined neither in nor out when viewed from behind. And then we're gonna move on to another one, but just to give you guys kind of a good idea, I would say that this is pretty close to ideal as far as age and maturity wise for the outline that you should be looking for. The outline of a Papillon is unmistakable. It is nothing like a Japanese chin, nothing like a Chihuahua. If you are two rings away from a Papillon, or if your Papillon is standing out in your yard, you know, in the dark, you should know what it is. You should see the head, you should see the tail. That's another kind of thing that's important to mention. The top line is level, but then the head with a neck of medium length and the tail pretty well match when you view them. What's the question?
Just had a question related to prosternum as well as angulation of shoulder. What kind of upper arm should you have?
A regular upper arm. I mean, it should not be a short upper arm. It should be a well-developed, well-laid-back shoulder. So when moving, they should have reach and drive. They should be a perfectly balanced dog. But keep in mind, the standard does say free, quick, and easy. So Papillons are pretty easy on their legs. They should never plod. They should never, kind of pull and lose pace. Their carriage and
they
shape.
They should never pace.
They should never pace. So they should be, as I mentioned, no movement anomalies on a Papillon.
The upper arm should measure equally.
So let's do, who's next?
The puppy?
No. Why don't you grab Phoebe?
Question just regarding a fault. Is a tail any more faulted, not arched rather than flat on the back?
So in the standard, there's actually three tail faults mentioned. There is a short tail, there is a tail that is not well arched over the back, and then there's a tail that's low set. So that would be the group. So they would all be pretty similar, I would say. Now, as far as judging goes, and honestly, as far as breeding goes, and this is purely our opinion, I would be inclined towards a little bit tighter tail more than a tail that is gay. Because a tail that's tight will mildly obscure the outline. A tail that is gay, that goes up like this, that never goes over the back, that doesn't even look like a papillon. Not to me.
You want to mention them dragging it?
And then, of course, you know, as we talk about tails, it's also important to mention, you see her kind of wagging her tail and everything like that. That's papillon temperament. That is what they're like. As I mentioned, they're not soldiers. That's how they are every day of their lives. If you are judging, you know, for all the judges out there, and you're in the ring and a papillon has its tail down, do not reward it. That is not our breed. That is the opposite of what they should be like. Now, if you're talking about a young dog that maybe has a funny moment and does recover, that's a different story. But a papillon that has a tail down for, you know, more than a split second in the ring, that is not acceptable. That's not something we should be breeding. That's not something we should be going in the ring with.
And it isn't acceptable to point at the dog after the handler's holding it together with its tail over.
Yeah, it's that's kind of something we were going to cover a little bit later, too. And I'm sure there will be some questions on that. Papillons, our standard does not specify anything about how they are shown. So they can be free baited, they can be hand stacked, and it really, there is no preference given. But with that being said, a papillon should be able to stand on their own. They should be able to free bait, they should be able to keep their tail up, they should be able to use their ears. Papillons are happy, as I mentioned earlier, happy, alert, friendly dogs, neither shy nor aggressive. I mean, what you should typically be seeing on a papillon is something that's overly happy, not unhappy.
Should a judge be penalizing missing teeth?
So our standard does not mention full dentition. It does mention, as I said, a scissors bite. I would say that if you're missing a tooth, it's really negligible. As long as you have a scissors bite, a scissors bite is correct. So if you're missing a front tooth, or even if you're missing a canine, a molar, our standard does not mention full dentition. So as a breeder, of course, you know, that might be something if you started to get, a line where you were getting dogs that, you know, didn't have full dentition or were missing teeth, you know, their baby teeth, you know, see, this is what they're like. So this is totally normal. Even if they do this on the table, totally normal. So back to the teeth, though, it would be a concern from a breeder standpoint if you started getting dog after dog that was maybe missing teeth. So that would not be something we would really want. But I would say as a judge, if you're missing, you know, one tooth or something, you could certainly ask the exhibitor, you know, what maybe might have happened. But it's not, you know, it's not a big concern. Oh, so I also, I can go back to it to show you guys. I'll go back to it. So this bitch is, as I mentioned, probably more like, more along the lines of, say, about 10 inches. And she would be a little bit more moderate. And as I said, so, you know, when you start getting the coat, a whole lot of coat like this, which is, you know, mentioned in the standard, as far as our standard says with coat, the first word mentioned is abundant. So abundant is abundant. It should never be sparse or lacking. With that being said, the last bitch we mentioned, which I'll put her back up after this one, is a younger bitch. So certainly she's going to have less coat. But some other words that are mentioned are straight, of resilient quality, so they should have a shine. Flowy, single coat, there is no undercoat. The chest is called profuse. It does also address the feathers on the legs, that they should diminish towards the pastern. It does also address the, what we call the pants, but the standard refers to them as breeches. So it says they should kind of stop at the hock, that they should be abundant to the hock. that's kind of an interesting thing, the way that that's mentioned, because, and most pet breeders would know this, when you have a dog or a bitch with really a full coat, which, as I said, this would be considered a pretty full coat, that's not true. The britches will typically grow past the start of the hock. So unless you're cutting them, you know, a dog in full coat that has abundant, silky, fine coat like the standard describes, they will grow past the hock. So that's just a kind of a point of interest. But again, to go over, so this bitch would be closer to 10 inches, still very, very fine boned, still a hair foot. The neck is of medium length.
Just touching on the coat, can you explain the difference between double coat, abundant coat, and fluffy coat?
Well,
please address the abundant part of the coat and the ears.
Okay, well, to start with, double, of course, is an undercoat. We have no undercoat. So if you're in doubt, if you're judging and you're in doubt, or even as a breeder, you can, of course, separate the coat and look underneath for there to be an undercoat. The other thing is that Papillon coat, and you'll see like hers is doing that, if you pick Papillon coat up and drop it, it should drop right back into place. Abundant is not fluffy, because abundant is then qualified by silky, single, of resilient quality, flowing, flat on the back, flat on the sides of the coat, of the body. So abundant would never be called fluffy. What I would say is that it's an abundant amount of the type of coat specified in the standard. So abundant, straight, silky, single, resilient quality coat. So basically the abundant is the qualifier as far as amount. It does not address, and you can kind of see like the coat drops. That's what it should do. It should stay down, and that's pretty normal. And then also to cover just because we're on.
How should the coat feel when you touch it?
And when you feel the coat, it should feel cool to the touch. A correct Papillon coat will feel cool to the touch. And then kind of just while the camera's up a little closer so you guys can see, what is specified in the standard as far as the ear fringe is well-fringed ears. So these would, of course, be considered that. And then the inside of the ear is covered with hair of medium, a silken hair of medium length. I'm not really sure where that comes in, to be honest, because as we said, it's a well-fringed ear. So that's basically just addressing the inside of the ear, which as you can see would not be quite as long, the coat. But so that's just kind of a point of interest. And then to cover again, as far as this bitch, so just to reiterate everything, as we mentioned, slightly longer than tall. So slightly longer from here to here than her height. As I said, she's about 10 inches. So pretty close to, you know, the middle of the standard would be 9.5. So she's a very, very good size from a breeder's perspective. She's kind of a pretty good size as far as what you would want to show and to breed as well. You can see her tail is well arched. You can very easily see the arch there. Shoulders well developed, well laid back. And then, of course, the rear should be well developed and well angulated. And then kind of, as I mentioned too, as the wind blows, you can sort of see, for the questions on coat, you can kind of see the coat moving in the wind. And that would, of course, be something you would see out and about of, you know, at an outdoor dog show or something like that. That's correct. Pap coat should never, as I mentioned earlier, you pick it up, it should drop. You can see the wind now, you can see it moving through the hair. It should never kind of stay stuck out, so to speak, because it is a silky single coat, which is very, very important for breed type and breed character. Can you grab me Bobby? I just wanted to show her coat again. We'll take her. Does anybody have any questions on her before she takes her? Does anybody have any questions on her? You can kind of, if I can maybe get her to use her ears. I don't know if she will. Can you fade her?
Hi. Phoebe. Phoebe.
Does anybody have any questions on her? No?
No. Not seeing any at this point, so.
Okay.
Just a quick question about color. She's a red sable.
Red sable, yep.
Not tan and white.
Yeah, and of course what sable even means is any black hair anywhere on the body. Clear reds are certainly allowed. I don't think they're as common as sables. You will see more sables. But as you can kind of see, if we go close to her ears, you can see the black there. And then you can see the black in her coat as well. She has quite a bit of sables.
She's a two-year-old Finnish bitch.
So this bitch is the one we showed you before.
She's 12 months.
Yeah, she's 12 months. But I just wanted to reiterate for the coat, because I know it can be a little hard to sometimes see and to differentiate with maturity. As we mentioned earlier, this bitch is younger, less mature. So you can kind of see the coat better on her, just because there's a little less of it. So you can see that the coat is silky, is fine. And this would be very similar coat texture to the last bitch, just a whole lot less of it. And as we mentioned, that's, certainly age appropriate, just the maturity and everything. But you can see it's kind of a similar texture, similar movement in the coat, silky, single, fine, of resilient quality. Can you grab Grace? Grace and then Lucifer.
A question regarding ear care for fringe. Anything that you do special?
Well, the ears, like this would just be for the breeders and exhibitors. So where the ears will really knot is right behind. At the base of their ears is typically where you'll see the knots. So that's very important to be keeping it brushed, clean, and in pretty good condition. I would recommend conditioner on PAPS, pretty much not necessarily for the shows, but between the shows. You want to have them pretty well conditioned, to stop the knots from forming. When they're in the yard, when they're playing, knots form pretty easily in their ears. So it is a fragile hair for sure. Stop. Can you come over here so I can even get her attention, because she's being pretty difficult. Mm-hmm. Just stay there. Don't talk to her. Just stay there. Again, as we mentioned, this is PAP temper. So this is not something, stop talking to her, something that you would fault. She's pretty up, pretty happy. As you can see, the tail's wagging the entire time. Totally, totally normal. So as we mentioned, she's about 10 inches, probably a similar size to the red bitch that we showed. And her top line is level as well. Stop. You can see her arch of her tail, neck of medium length. You can see she has beautiful coat texture and a whole lot of it for a bitch.
If there was one thing that you would like to tell a Papillon judge, that is the most important thing about a Papillon, what would you say?
So I would say two things. The first thing is Papillons. The hallmark of a Papillon is their ears. There are many, many things on our standard that are mentioned in other standards. The only breed that you will ever see with ears like a butterfly's, whether erect or drop, is a Papillon. So the ears are the thing that, as breeders and as judges, should not, in my opinion, you should not give on that. They should be large, they should be well fringed, they should be round. And they make a Papillon a Papillon. As a side note though, another thing I would mention, so our standard mentions the word fine boned four times. So it says fine boned in our standard four separate times as well as being in the general appearance. And so a Papillon is elegant. They are fine boned. They should never appear clunky. They should never appear coarse. The fine bone goes with the hair feet. They should not have a round foot. So those two are the two things that I would say are the biggest. If I had to choose, ears. Ears are the hallmark of the breed. They are absolutely important. And they are what, those things, the ears and the bone, to be honest, along with a level back, an arched tail, and pretty head proportions, a pleasing expression, they are what makes a Papillon a Papillon. They are breed type. Don't give on breed type. Breed type is so important. It's what sets our dogs apart from any other breed. And then just to qualify that, of course, as I mentioned earlier, temperament. Temperament, temperament, temperament. If they are not happy, they are not a Papillon. We don't want that in our breeding program. We don't want that in the ring. That is not what they are. So just again to kind of cover just another, you know, another size and a different dog. This is, as we mentioned earlier, another bitch. I would say her proportions are pretty good. Slightly longer than tall. Stop. She's being very difficult. Slightly longer than tall. Good straight front, good straight rear. Level back, archy tail, neck of medium length, beautiful coat texture, a lot of it. She's sledding. Ribs well sprung. I don't know if I mentioned that earlier. So they should have some chest. They are never going to feel like a Bichon or something like that, a Havanese, you know, that really has like a lot of chunk to them. Because they are so elegant and fine boned. So they will have ribs well sprung, they will have some body. You know, you should feel a dog under there. But don't be alarmed, you know, if you're not feeling a very substantial dog. Because that is, you know, that does go with the fine bone. Let's grab the puppy and then we'll go to Lucifer.
Just address grooming products a little bit. Do you have a favorite?
Yeah, I will do the grooming products once we kind of cover all of this. Can you put a brush shirt in too for me? Okay, so this is an 8-month-old. And I think it's important to show, especially the judges, the different levels of maturity. So this is an 8-month-old male. Now, I would say he's about 9.5 inches right now. He will probably end up to be a very similar size to the very first dog we had on the table. So as you can see, and so sometimes when you have a puppy, things can be a little more evident, you know, just in the size and shape and, you know, where the legs are and everything like that. So with him, you can kind of pretty well see that the line is low. You can see that he has a well-angulated rear. You can see that the shoulders are well laid back. You can see the medium length. You can see the tail. Sometimes the tail at young ages, you know, whether they're unsure or whether they're maybe still teething, you know, tails on puppies this age, I would say, could be a little looser. Just like from a judging perspective, it wouldn't be uncommon to see. I'm not saying that you should forgive that, but that is something, you know, that you could see. Now, it's important, too, to notice the coat. You know, you can see the wind moving through it. This is a beautiful coat, beautiful, fine, silky coat. I would say this is a pretty moderate maturity level on a puppy this age. You may see a little less mature. You may see a little more mature. If you ever see a puppy, whether you're a breeder or an exhibitor or a judge, if you ever see a puppy that you believe appears to be kind of round coat, round bone, round shape, that is not correct. They should always be slender, fine-boned, silky-coated dogs. So you would kind of see, like this would be, as I mentioned, kind of a very adequate level of maturity. And then also just to show you his head too. So for him, for his age, so his ears are a beautiful size, beautiful shape. They are round. They are well fringed. Now, you will see different amounts of fringe again on, you know, different ages. So this dog is going to have a ton of ear fringe. He's going to have probably like the very first dog would have, very similar. But just kind of to cover his head as well. So stop. He has a well-defined stop. He's 1/3 from the nose to the stop, and then 2/3. So 1/2 from the stop to the occiput. Again, this dog, clearly defined white blaze. And so another thing to point out on him, is you see on his muzzle, he has a couple of freckles. So that is, again, not really mentioned in our standard. And it is a Continental Toy Spaniel. So they were certainly freckled. They were certainly freckled, you know, at, kind of in their origin, I would say. That's not anything I would penalize. Now, the markings are said to kind of form the body of the butterfly. So the ears are the wings, of course, and then the markings would form the body. So again, it's just degrees. So it's, you know, how you feel about, you know, any certain thing that is maybe not ideal in your mind. As I mentioned, this is a very pretty puppy head, I would say. He is, as I mentioned, 8.5 months old, and he actually does not have his adult teeth yet, his adult upper canines. So that may be something, judges, that you may see. And, I mean, not anything, his bite is scissors, not anything you would want to penalize. And then just to point out again, hair, foot. Fine bone. And you know, that's evident kind of, as I mentioned, on all different ages.
Just comment on the current dogs that you see in the ring. What would be the most common faults?
Temperament. Flat tail.
So I would say you will see a lot of poor temperaments. You will see a lot of less than desirable ears, I would say. Which those, again, are things that we don't really want to give on. So now, to cover just the maturity and, you know, how it does kind of change how you will see... you know, the body lines and everything. So this dog is 3, and this dog certainly has an abundant coat. But with that being said, it's an abundant correct coat. As we kind of mentioned earlier, you can see it's straight, you can see it's silky, you can see it's fine. You can see there's no undercoat. But you know, there is sometimes, people will often mention, you know, that you can get too much coat, and things like that. Now, as I mentioned before, abundant, profuse. So those things are very, very important. So I would say, so this dog is probably about 10.5, 10.75. He is slightly longer than tall, neck of medium length, shoulders well laid back. He has a whole lot of body. He is an adult dog, as we mentioned. You can see the tail. You can see it's well arched. Daylight under it. You can see, like I said, abundant, silky, profuse coat. Fine bone, hair, foot, which is all things you should be looking for. And then I think we're just going to show Mickey again. Are there any questions?
Not at this point.
Okay, so this is the first dog you guys saw. So this dog would be on the smaller side of what you will see in the ring. He is about 9 3/4. He is a finished champion. He is probably smaller than most everything you'll see in the specials ring. Which is unfortunate because he actually is, I mean, pretty much in the middle of the standard. And you know, a lot of times when you get Papillons that do start getting really big, a lot of times they do get heavy as well. So that is a concern. As I said, he is kind of in the middle of the standard. Now, as far as he goes, he's a moderate dog. He has, I would say he's a little shorter backed than some you would see. And I mean, I wouldn't go as far as to call him cobby, but he is definitely shorter backed. As I mentioned, they should be slightly longer than tall. He still does have pretty coat, a profuse frill. He has fine bone. He has beautiful hair feet. You can see the tail. I mean, even just standing there, you can see the tail is very archy. And you can see shoulders well laid back. Hindquarters well developed, well angulated. Scissors bite, as we mentioned. And we kind of said this would be pretty close to ideal as far as head type goes. Head type, ears, you know, and breed type, to be honest. Okay, are there any questions?
I'm not seeing any right this second.
Why don't you grab Bobby so we can show the different sizes?
There was a question. Do you think Papillons are getting bigger and heavier in bone? Why this trend around the world? Why do breeders accept it?
Absolutely. So Papillons in the States, as we mentioned, should be 8 to 11 inches. Over 11 to 12. Hold on one second, guys. Just there. The FCI standard says 28 centimeters. So that's about 11 and a third. You can pick his head up. So this bitch, compared to this dog, you can kind of see standing here, she's about 1 1/4 inches bigger than him. But that being said, the proportions, the outlines are not that dissimilar. Just as a side note, I mean, two dogs are very, very related. But you can kind of see the difference in size, you know, between these two. As we mentioned too, something to point out again is the markings. So this would be what we consider perfectly marked. And then this would be a darker dog, you know, more narrow blaze. Both are totally acceptable. One is not, you know, more desirable from a judging perspective. Breeders have all kinds of preferences, but as far as judging goes, one is no better than the other. And then also kind of why, while they're standing here, why don't you hold over? Come over to the side. I want to show the head. Just kind of to give you an idea as far as the head go, you can kind of see standing here. You can kind of see the difference. So you see how, as we mentioned, his is pretty close to ideal. Hers is not. Hers is a little flatter behind, a little longer in muzzle. I would say she's not quite 1/3, 2/3. Hers kind of goes like, if you
much further back, like to the base of the skull.
Longer
in muzzle, not as pretty a stop, and not as pretty a shape of a head either, but still a pleasing expression and certainly nothing you would throw out in your ring or in your breeding program. But if you can kind of see, why don't you show from the side? You can definitely see the difference when you look from the side. Can you grab Phoebe? I'll keep them. Can look different and stuff, you know, comparatively speaking. These two, as I mentioned before, are kind of similarly marked, but she does have the smudge. But, you know, they are both certainly pleasing, alert, you know, pretty. Okay. But if you, you know, if you kind of look, do you guys have a toy?
No, I'll go get one.
There's one in that side of the trolley. Phoebe. But just to compare the two sizes, or the two colors, sorry, you can kind of, you know, they're both Mickey. They're both very pleasing, you know, very pretty. So it doesn't, it should not matter. There is no color preference, as we said before. It's more important that they have the black pigment than anything. And then also, grab me Oscar. I also want to show you guys just kind of an age comparison.
Can you also talk about the difference between a correct rounded skull compared to a head that is more apple-headed, i.e. a chihuahua?
Yeah. I don't really have an example to show. Hold one second, and we'll answer that one second on the apple-headed. You want to look in? So this is a 4-year-old dog. This is an 8-month-old dog. So definitely, you know, worlds apart as far as maturity goes. With that being said, they're very similar type dogs. You need to stack it so they can see. They are pretty similar as far as in type. This dog will probably be quite like this dog at maturity, for sure. So next, I think we're gonna show you guys one of the dogs on the ground moving, and then also we're gonna do a litter evaluation. So you guys can kind of give, what we're going to do with the litter evaluation is we are going to put the three puppies up on the table. So you can see them. And we're not going to say anything. We're going to have you guys give your opinion. And then we'll give you ours at the end of it. I'm going to do him on the ground.
And then I also, before we do that though, I do want to cover some things that we had mentioned about, that we had mentioned as far as judging. So one big one is, you know, if you're a judge and you get in the ring and you like a dog that looks nothing like the others, that does not mean it's wrong. Just because it's different does not mean it's wrong. Oftentimes, you know, you could have 20 dogs in the ring. If there's one, there may be one that is the correct breed type. Don't fault it. Refer back to your standard. That's what, I mean, you know, a lot of times, you know, you have to differentiate. And so it's important, you know, to remember that. Some other things, what we always tell people at seminars and things like that, as we kind of touched on before, examine them on the table, judge them on the ground. Papillons, as you can see, are kind of flighty, kind of crazy. They aren't always going to be, you know, so slow and steady on the table. They aren't just going to stand up there like a soldier. And that kind of goes for in the line as well. You know, you'll see Papillons, you know, spin around, look at something, look at the person behind them, you know, look at all different sorts of things. That's okay. They are not soldiers, like I said. Happy, alert, friendly. They are not going to just stand there.
Is it common for a tail to be down on the table and then up on the ground?
I would say you may see that. Although I don't, you know, we put however many up here and I don't think any of them really have their tail down. So, I mean, if you may see that, that's not anything I would penalize. I would penalize the tail being down on the ground, not on the table. Because as we said, they don't always love the table. Some other things as far as judging goes, and we've mentioned this earlier, please do not reward a Papillon that doesn't have the correct ear. Whether it is erect or drop, it needs to either be completely up or completely down. Nowhere in between, that doesn't matter if it's 6-9 or best of breed. It has to be one or the other. It cannot be anywhere in between, up or down. As far as the felines go, they are more rare, so you won't see as many of them, but they are absolutely not to be penalized. You know, if you like a feline and it's the best one you have, and you know, please reward it. They are not, you know, a second class of anything. They are absolutely a Papillon with a drop ear. Papillons and felines are exhibited together. So with the exception of a national or a specialty in which you might have a pack, you might have a drop ear class, they are together. So they're shown in best of breed together. They're shown in all the other classes together. Let me check and just make sure there's nothing I'm missing. Two things. So, and I think I touched on this earlier. Papillons do have a disqualification as far as size. So it's at 12 inches, but over 11 is a full. So when you wicket a Papillon, you're going to wicket at 12. So you're never going to know if it's over 11. That would just be a question of being experienced enough to see it. As breeders, we would not really penalize over 11 more than anything else. Because to be honest, you will very, very rarely see a Papillon that is 12 inches. You will also very rarely see a Papillon that is 8, although that's allowed in our standard. So you could have 8, you could have 8.5, you could have 9. From a breeder's perspective, we typically wouldn't have anything probably a whole lot less than 9.25 inches. So, and then that goes for 11 as well. I mean, we would not hesitate to keep a calf that we really liked that was over 11. So that is a fault just like anything else. Whenever you're faulting, you need to remember it's the extent of the deviation. And if you have any questions about that, it's more important that the fault something that is a deviation from breed type, not a deviation just from, you know, any dog. You know, an east-west front. If you have two dogs that are equal, except the fact that one has an east-west front and the other one has a small pointed ear, fault the ears. That's the hallmark of a breed. We don't give on that. That is so important. Always remember, breed type.
Are all faults in the breed mentioned in the standard equal?
So there are severely penalized faults, which I mentioned earlier. There are two of them. One of them is a nose not black. That's something you'll rarely see in the ring, I would say. The other one is a mismark, which we covered. Remember, the eyes and ears both need to be covered in an unbroken line. That's another thing I don't think you'll really see in a ring. You definitely will see it. You know, it does crop up in puppies and in breeding programs. And then there are four different sets of faults mentioned in the standard.
Another question. Is there a weight range?
Well, 1 second. We'll answer that one next. So the faults that are explicitly stated in the standard that are just faults, they are over 11 inches. They are undershot or overshot. They are a small pointed ear or an ear that is too high set. Now that is an interesting point because an ear that is too low set is not explicitly faulted in our standard. But to be honest, it's the same. An ear that's high or an ear that's low is the same. It doesn't make a difference which one. So if you're judging them, I would not place a greater importance on a high set ear than a low set ear. You know, any deviation from correct, which remember correct, 45 degrees of an alert, is a fault. Does not make a difference. And then the other faults we mentioned earlier are the tail faults. So a tail that is not arched over the back, a tail that is low set, or a tail that is short. And if the next question is going to be how long should the tail be, I don't really know. It doesn't say. There is no specific thing on how long it should be. I would tell you that the tail does need to touch the tip of the back. So if you're looking at this dog, this is plume. So it does say that the tail is covered with a long flowing plume. This is where his tail ends. So, I mean, it's about half of what the plume is. Now, you could see it maybe a little better on the puppy. The puppy doesn't have a lot of plume. So that's all tail. So now the next question was weight.
There's two questions. One, is there a weight range? And your second question would be, are all of the faults weighted equally? Is there one more important than that?
Okay, so I thought we answered that one.
We did.
That was the one we just answered on the severely penalized or the regular faults that are mentioned. But regular. As we said, any deviation is a fault.
Are they weighted equally?
There are severely penalized faults, and then there is regular faults. So it would just be a question of how you weight them. In the ring, in your breeding program, as an exhibitor, it's how you weight them. What's important to you? As I mentioned earlier, what would be important to us above anything is breed type. And that is what I mentioned. Ears, hallmark of a breed, fine bone, head type, a level back, a pretty tail, pretty coat. Those are elements of breed type. And then not to be forgotten, the breed character, which as we talked about is the temperament. As far as the weight goes, so weight is in relation to height. The biggest thing to remember is that they are a fine bone dog. So that does not matter if they are 8 inches, 11 inches, or 12 inches. They are fine bone. And that was kind of what I was showing you earlier with the different sizes. The bone is the same relative to their size. So a dog this size, which remember we said is about 9 3/4, compared to the young bitch we showed who was about 11, of course, she has more bone than he has. But she doesn't have more bone relative to her height. They are both fine bone. So that doesn't change.
Leg length as proportion to size?
The proportions are slightly longer than tall. So if you're going to ask slight, what is slight? If you are on a cliff and I told you to take a slight step, how far would you step? It is a little bit. They are essentially an off-square breed. But they should never appear long. Never, ever, ever should they appear long. They should never appear low either. Because remember, the standard says elegant. So So the elegance is more important, you know, and does kind of define the proportions, I would say.
When they talk about the fault being equal.
Now, okay, guys, so when alert. We've been saying when alert. So that was alert. Now, on the ground, you'll get a whole lot more of that than you will on the table. But that is when you're judging yourself, is when alert. And that is so important because many, many judges, you know, will stand up at the table and fuss at them and expect they're going to get something, and they're not. So that's alert, guys. That's what, you know, that, and that's an absolutely a beautiful ear set. And that's what you're looking for. But as I said, you know, you will have to wait till they're alert to see it. What's a question?
When they address to one fault being more important than the other, I just have to say, and I'm probably wrong, my favorite fault is a little bit too much neck. It's so pretty. That says moderate, but...
Medium,
moderate, length. Yeah, medium length. But, and when you look at it, do you do it with your hands?
Yeah, we mentioned this earlier, guys. So, you know, for judges and even for exhibitors, so a papillon, you know, you should see ears and tail. They balance each other. So you'll see ears, tail, and you should see a level top line. The neck, of course, should be, you know, well set into that as well. But that is the shape that you should be seeing. Ears and tail. I know some people had questions before we go ahead and move him. Some people had questions on grooming and trimming, etc. So I know I had touched on the handling aspect and the free baiting and the hard stack. And remember I said a papillon should always be able to kind of stand up on their own on the ground and even on the table as well. It is, you know, it's important that they be able to stand on their legs. And then as far as the grooming goes, so they are a wash and wear breed for the most part. Now they do need their the pads of their feet kept trimmed, of course. If you don't trim the feet themselves, they will grow like cavalier feet. You know, they have very hairy feet, so those get trimmed as well. As far as the coats and stuff go, you shouldn't have to be stripping undercoat. You shouldn't have to be doing, you know, they don't have a jacket, nothing like that. It is a wash and wear breed. You know, shampoo them, condition them, comb them, and blow them dry. And then as far as blowing dry, just to touch a little bit on that, basically a papillon has a silky single straight coat. So when you're blowing them dry, you would want to kind of blow dry everything one way. You know, don't blow against the coat. Because if you do, you may not get the single straight silky coat. They're not a breed that has to be flat ironed or anything like that. To be honest, if you touched ear fringe with a flat iron, I mean, I think we'd all be horrified. As far as the grooming goes, I would say condition over groom. If this is not a breed that, you know, if you don't take care of them, that you can just, you know, fix it overnight. You know, a little bleach and, you know, whatever is going to fix it. It's not. Their coats need to be in good condition. They need to be cared for. I would say bathe your pap about once a week, maybe for show dogs twice a week. As we mentioned on the ear fringe, keep the ear fringe brushed and not knotted. If you don't, you won't end up with anything like this or, you know, it is fragile hair. We do have a few products that we were going to mention that we do use. So this line, if you want to come closer, is one that we love. Premium Show Pet Grooming Products. We use just about everything that they make. Now, this is the silk treatment line. They also make a clarifying that's fabulous. They make an anti-sap spray that we love. These are wonderful. You can't go wrong with anything they make. They have a pink flamingo as well that's great for, you know, just for at-home baths and stuff like that. This is another one. It's called Famous Skincare. So they have a shampoo and a conditioner. It's called Growth. That I love for at home. It's a little too heavy for the show, but it will do a great job keeping the knots out and keeping them, you know, pretty well conditioned against, you know, things in the yard and burrs and trees and things like that.
Another thing we love is Fraser Essentials makes two different sprays. This is the brushing, and they also make a coat stimulant spray. Both of them are fabulous, great for the ears, great for the all over the dog. They don't leave a residue. They're great to go through the coat, you know, and leave a good sheen, but not too much.
Do you have a recommendation for tear stains?
Tear stains. So this line of products makes a tear stain process, which is something that you put in the water, something you put on the food, and then a powder as well, and a cleaner and a powder. It is a four-step process. You need commitment and dedication. If you want to do that and you're committed to 2-3 times a day as far as washing it, and then of course, like I said, the water with the supplement and the supplement for the food, it will work. Many of our red sables get quite a bit of tear staining, and as you guys saw, I mean, we don't really have the tear stain. So if you are dedicated and you know, and committed to it, you can absolutely get the faces, you know, pretty white and clean.
They can PM you for the...
Yeah, you guys, any questions you have, like on the products or anything like that, I know it's hard to hear and hard to see on this, so just write me privately, and I can send you the links for any of them. And then another thing I wanted to mention before we get into the movement and the litter evaluation is, so this is a pamphlet that was done by a couple of breeders in our breed. Unfortunately, our parent club does not have an illustrated standard currently. So this is a great tool for judges, for exhibitors, and it's pretty affordable. I think it's like maybe $10 or something. And it is fabulous. It has all kinds of drawings you'll see, and diagrams, like with the ears of the ears compared to the wings of the butterfly, the measurements that you should have for proportions, for head proportions, for bite. So this is fabulous. And as I said, it was done by a couple of breeders, Jerry Lynn Naylor and Jane Snyder, long time breeders. And if you guys are interested in this, I can also point you in the direction of it via private message. So we're just gonna show you the movement so you guys can kind of see. Did anybody have any questions before? Any more? Like on the dogs or the standard? Now, just to reiterate, before we move them, guys, shoulders well developed, well laid back. Hind quarter well developed, well angulated. They should be balanced. Level top line, neck of medium length. The tail should be carried over the back. The gait is free, quick, and easy, not paddle-footed or stiff in hip movement. So our standard is not super descriptive on movement, but as we mentioned, no movement anomaly in our breed.
Would you say you see a lot of Papillons with lacking rear angulation?
No, I don't think so. We'll do it again just so you guys can see.
The grass is a tad high. I'm sorry, guys.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions? No.
Lead placement. Do you keep it taut?
It's not specified. You can answer that. Answer it.
It's not really specified in the breed, in the standard regarding a taut lead. That's a personal preference. A lot of judges prefer loose lead. Again, it's more a question of circumstance.
And then you guys can kind of see too, on the ground, you can see the ears a lot better. Hey, Mickey. Anybody have any questions? Okay, let's take them back up. We're gonna do the litter evaluation now, guys.
Let them see them in the pen.
Okay. I can do it.
What do they want to do?
A younger dog?
The puppy, maybe?
Yeah. Maybe a little bit of the cow in the grass.
Show them the puppy while you're doing that.
Oh, yeah, you can just...
Why don't you show them the pen?
Tell them, like,
oh, these are the babies that we're going to be doing the litter evaluation on. They're just hanging out. They really want out.
Give me 1 second to get him walking.
Back up where you fell.
They're 14 weeks, 13, 14 weeks.
The puppies are about 15 weeks. Oh, behave.
So you want to move great.
Be nice.
There's a classic try. Hound try.
Oh yeah, show them the hound try.
The hound try is a variation on a try. It's kind of a reverse try, for lack of a better way to put it.
Yeah, so this would be what's considered a hound try. Come here, guys. You want either one. And you can kind of see it's a reverse color pattern of a try. So instead of having black with a little bit of tan, this tan will get lighter and lighter. There'll be more of it, and it'll basically be tan tipped in black, as opposed to this, which is black tipped in tan. You can see the difference. We can just take him down and back real quick. So, Nate. Do it again. He's a little wild. You stay put. I'm gonna do it again. He's being wild.
Go across.
Okay. So that should give you guys a pretty good idea. The grass is a little long. You want to do them now?
Sure.
Are there any questions? Okay, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna put the three of them up. You saw them in the pen, and you guys are gonna give your opinion on how you see it based on everything we've told you guys. So this is a boy. Now, this is not something I mentioned. So there is no difference in a male or a female. There are no sex characteristics in the way they act or the way they look. So, males should not be masculine, so to speak. Girls should not be feminine. They are all fine bone and all of the above. You just do all three sides. So, this will be puppy one.
Just do the back.
He has two testicles.
Tell them about the ear because he's teething.
It's up though. Yeah, this puppy's ear this morning, one of them was not up. Now this isn't for the evaluation aspect. I mean, they're up totally fine, but just, you know, breeders, of course, every breeder knows that Papillon ears will teeth and kind of go up and down, and it relates, you know, to the teething and the growing stages and phases, and there's really nothing to be concerned about that. Mm-hmm. It's just that, as I mentioned over and over again, when you get them in the ring, they need to be up or down. They cannot be anywhere in between. Okay, so that's the first puppy, puppy one. Now, oh, just for reference, these puppies are about 12 weeks old.
No, I had said 15, so I misspoke.
So this is the girl. This can be puppy two. Stop. Moving. Okay. And remember, guys, these were hound tries, which is the different, the reverse color pattern, one and two, of a classic tricolor. All totally acceptable. So this is going to be puppy three. Yeah, both boys have testicles.
Dead.
Hold on. Okay, so you guys now go ahead and give your evaluation. You know, just say what would be first. Maybe it might be better to say puppy A, B, and C, just for simplicity's sake, so you guys can go 1, 2, 3. Are we getting answers?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
So far, we have a couple of puppy ones. Another one. Another one. But the girl has such a cute face. Another one. Another one. Another one. Nicely balanced and super. Number one, love him. Natasha Baxter, puppy one. Robert, and I'm going to butcher it. Martin Meter, number one. Helena, I don't want to butcher your name. It's another puppy one. Puppy A, better, balanced all around. Puppy one.
Okay. You guys can keep giving them. We'll give you our opinion. Give me.
What's right and what's wrong with them? No.
You want to just start one? Okay.
Right, someone asked earlier, do we always agree?
No.
Typically, never.
Never.
We never agree.
Never. No.
Can you say never?
Okay.
Never. A, B, and C, puppy one, A, B, and C.
Okay, guys. So, remember the whole time, this whole time, I've been saying to you guys.
At what age do you give up if the boys don't have testicles?
Ours typically have them till at about 8 or 10 weeks. We've not had a lot of experience with them coming down after that. Although I've heard many, many times, I've heard stories
Dorothy
about that.
Dorothy DeStefano, BAC.
Okay.
One, puppy two.
Okay. So, this is puppy one, or A, whatever. So remember, guys, I've been saying over and over and over again, fine boned. This puppy, I mean, may end up fine boned. But today, he's not. This puppy is strong boned. Rounder foot, more head. He has beautiful, beautiful ears. Well set. He has a beautiful face. Pretty head proportions, 1/3 to 2/3. I would not say at this point that his head is small for the size of his body. I mean, it's in proportion, but it's not small and fine boned and dainty. His body is beautiful. I think he's very balanced, front, rear, pretty top line, pretty tail, beautiful neck, beautiful carriage. He has a great temperament. His pigment is black. His eyes are sweet and soft and alert in expression. As we said, his bite is good. His ears, again, are absolutely phenomenal. But he does lack, I would say, in the fine bone department. Now that could change. But that would be the reason that at this point he wouldn't be first for us, because
they usually do refine.
They do refine a lot of times, as they ours do at least. Typically, our ones that are very, very small don't usually get quite big enough for us to keep and breed. Whereas ones like this, most times will come down a little bit in bone. He will never be fine boned like the 8-month-old male we showed.
And we don't keep anything over 11 ever.
Okay, so that's puppy one. So I would say this puppy would probably be second for us. So this is puppy two or puppy B. Okay, so again, that's kind of why I pointed this out. No sex characteristics. This is the first pick, for sure. So her head is beautiful. Her ears are beautiful. 1/3, 2/3. Her expression is alert and pleasing. Her ears are big. They're well set. They're very, very round. Her bite is good. Her front's good. Her rear's good. Her top line's good. Her tail's pretty. She is way more fine boned than that first puppy. You can see if you zoom in on her feet, like showed her back feet, you can see the hare foot. Which is what we're looking for. We love her. We think she's pretty special. So this would definitely be our first pick.
That doesn't mean anything.
You never know. I mean, it doesn't mean that, you know, they're both very pretty. But it doesn't mean that she, you know, he may not end up the pick. You never really know. And that's as a side note. We typically don't make a lot of choices before about this age. Yeah, I know some other breeds, they pick puppies at 8 weeks. We typically don't. But this would be our first pick. So this would be our third pick. And this is puppy C. He doesn't have as much neck, which you can kind of see. His shoulders are not as well laid back. You can see they're, you know, pretty far up. He does have a fine bite. He has a pleasing expression. He is a little scoopier in stop right now. You can kind of see, remember, it's well defined. I would say right here it's not well defined at this point. And the problem with that is that this age, he's a little young to be in what we would call the uglies. So I don't know if that will or won't fix. He is not as strong on his rear. Remember we said hindquarters, you know, parallel when viewed from behind, inclined neither in or out. So I would say he's not quite as strong on his rear. They all look like they'll have a lot of coat. He has also, this is something interesting to notice, and I don't know if we'll be able to see it up here. His ear set is high. So remember, 45 degrees when alert, which if I push him up, I mean, that would be pretty close to alert. Hold on a second. I can't really get him to do it, but his ears are a little high set. And as we kind of said, he's not as pretty here. Yeah, and for the breeders, I mean, the teething can certainly affect the ear set as well. He has a pretty arched tail, but like I said, you know, kind of in shape and stuff. You know, not quite as together, not quite as sound.
There was a question, does temperament influence when you pick?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, remember we keep saying over and over again, temperament's so important. We don't, we typically don't give a whole lot on temperament. Because honestly, a puppy at this age that's soft is really going to end up most likely pretty soft. Because puppies at this age love everybody and everything. I mean, you can hear all the noises, they're not bothered. You know, they're in the grass, they're happy, they're up, they're alert. You know, at this age, if you really have, and we should put them up for the two. I'm going to put the two up for you guys to see just one and two, so also, you can kind of see what we're talking about with the bone. Yeah, sure.
Also, for the breeders, you can't show the shy dog if it's behind your leg, if it's not going to win. And if you breed it, a lot of times you'll get shy. I mean, that's what we found. If we, you know, tried to breed them, usually your puppy is shy too.
So guys, just to show you the bone difference on the two puppies. Now obviously some will say, oh well, you know, might one be bigger. And yeah, I mean he probably will be.
Beautiful bone.
But you see her bone is fine boned and you know, slender and fine and everything that the standard says, where his is a little rounder for sure.
And his is beautiful. He has pretty bone.
This puppy's bone is very good.
Very fine.
Yep.
Very fine bone.
Yep.
Very hair footed.
Any other questions?
What? No.
No?
Come on, Mike. Come over here.
Okay. Mike? So, guys, if you do have any questions, please private message us. We're happy to answer on anything we cover. And otherwise, you know, everybody stay safe out there. And thanks for watching.
Thank you for watching.
It's been fun.
Everybody stay safe.
Yeah.
And see you at the next show.
Bye, guys.
Bye, guys.